A very good morning to one and all present here. My name is Neha and I'm representing Atharvid today. I've been a part of Atharvid from past 7 months and it's been an amazing and extraordinary journey for me. And the amount of learning I have done in this past 7 months is very huge. And today we'll be learning about the basics of programming language. So as you know, everybody is very much interested in coding these days. So we have put up C programming language as the basic language for you to understand the basic necessity for you to learn coding and why C programming language is necessary. I'll be teaching you in this past 1 hour session, and we'll have a great session, hopefully. And looking forward to have amazing interaction with you guys by the end of the session. The first 30 minutes will be having a PPT presentation, and I'll be teaching you programs regarding each concepts through code blocks. So let me just start my presentation now. So why do we need to know the basics of coding? Learning the fundamentals of programming language is the first place any aspiring developer should start. So I'm assuming that everybody who are here at presently want to know what exactly is coding, right? So for you to know what exactly is coding, you need to be very strong with your basics. So for you to be very strong with your basic, you need to know C language. C language is much better because it's very easy, user friendly, and it is very understandable also. You'll also learn coding a lot faster if you want to learn Python, Java, or any other languages. Say you want to learn Java, or say you want to learn Python. Python will have the same similar functionalities that is there in C or C++. So that's why we are taking up C today. And let's just dig deep into what exactly are the concepts in C language. The first one is nothing but data types. So in data types, we have programming. In data types, we need to know what is data. So what exactly is data? Data is nothing but facts and figures, numbers or names or any characters that is there in and around, okay? We as a programmer, what do? We take up data and then we result it into an extraordinary output, right? Look out there in Amazon companies or something like that. They have coded their app in such a beautiful way that it's making us, making things very much easier for us to online shopping, right? So that's how we as a programmer need to use these data and play around with it. Data is usually represented by what we call data types, which can include words, numbers, and other kinds of complex data. So data types are classified into three categories in C language, and that is basic, derived, and user-defined. Basic data types have four types, that is integer data types, float data types, double data type, and character data type. Derived data type and user-defined data types are very vast topics, and they have to be learned in a very nice or a very better way. So we are not gonna go to talk about derived data type and user defined data type in today's session. So we'll be just handling basic derived data types. The first one is nothing but int. Int is nothing but integers, okay? Integers are whole numbers without any fractional parts. The integers can be both positive or negative values. Integer can hold data up to minus 32,768 to plus 32,767. This is nothing but the range of a data a person data an integer data can hold. You have memory space in our computer system, right? So integer will have will occupy 2 bytes of memory space in our computers. Examples for integer or int data type is 10, minus 20, 0, etc. Next up, we have float. Float represents a number with fractional part, that is real numbers. It can also be negative and positive. The range of numbers that a floating point number can hold is minus 3.4 into 10 to the power minus 38 to 3.4 into 10 to the power 38. In our computer system, it can hold up to 4 bytes of memory space. An example for float is 10.5, 45.0, and minus 5.75. Note that floating point will have a precision of about 6 to 7 after the decimal point. Double is similar to a float. Okay. The only difference between float and double is double has 8 bytes of memory space, and the float can have precision up to 6 to 7. That is decimal. After the decimal point, it can hold numbers only of up till 6 to 7, whereas double can hold up to 15 to 16 precision point after the decimal point. Example, why we need double in our daily life is just take a CEO of the company. His salary figure is very huge, right? So in order to take the entire salary figure, we need double precision. Next up, we have character. Character data type is used to store a single character. A character must be surrounded by single quotes. Like as I've mentioned over here, that is A and then C. It should always be in single quotation mark whenever you are representing a character. They occupy 1 byte of memory space. And remember, computers doesn't know like English, right? They don't even understand what we are talking right now. So it always compiles the letters or numbers into its ASCII code. ASCII code is nothing but American standard of code for information and interchange. This particular thing is a 7-bit character set containing 128 characters in it. It contains number from 0 to 9, the uppercase and lowercase English letters from A to Z. So it treats small letter A differently than capital letter A. Small letter A has ASCII code of 097. Capital letter A has ASCII code of 065. So whenever you're typing A in your computer, it just interprets one of these things. If you put capital letter A, then it'll take 065 and converts into its code and then communicates with the computer. So that's how characters work. Next up, we have variables. Why do we need variables? Just like how we have names, similarly, data also should have name. Why do we need to name data? Because late, when you're coding and if you want that particular data to be retrieved later on or use it later on, you need to mention it, right? Like what exactly you need that particular thing. That's the sole reason why you're giving a data a variable name. So example, if I'm taking n should be of an integer data type. So in our syntax, we give a data type as int, and n can hold only integer kind of data types. That's why we are giving variable names, and variable names do not hold the data. It just points to that particular data. A variable name cannot start with a number. It can consist of alphabets, number, and underscore. And next up, we have keywords. Keywords are nothing but predefined reserved words in C language, and each of this has its own meaning. Okay, so if you're taking int, and if you're taking if, and if you're taking character, all of this have different meaning, right? Int is nothing but integer, float is nothing but floating point number. You cannot use it as a variable name because it has its own meaning and it's representing something in the C language, and it has its own functionality. So we have a lot of set of keywords in our C language library. Next up, we have C input and output functions. What is input? Input means to provide the program with some data. And what is output? Output means to display that data on the screen. I'm just going to show you an example. I'm using C code blocks to learn C language or C++. I highly refer you guys to use code blocks because it's very user friendly, first of all. And in order for you to just create a new thing, you just have to go to file, a new project, and then console application. If you want to learn C, you can just click on C, next, and then just give a title saying webinar, next, finish. Click on source main.c and you'll have your new page where you can just code whatever you want in C language. I'll just show you the structure of a C program. If you want to document anything and it should not display on your compiler screen or something like that, you need to write those things in double slash and those won't be displayed on the display screen, and that is nothing but comment section. This is called linker section. Hashtag include standard.io.h. Standard.io.h is nothing but library function. These library functions will have many input and output functions in it. And next up, we have a define or definition section. Here we are defining a particular variable and we are giving a constant value to that particular variable. So whenever you're typing pi over here in your main function, the value of pi will remain 3.14 constant throughout the program, no matter what. So that's why we are using a definition section. And this is nothing but the main section where you write your entire program. Let's look up to input and output functions. Here we have I, it's a variable name and it is of integer data type. Here we define the variable, okay? And next up we have printf. What is printf? Printf statement is used to display a message on the screen asking the user to input a value. So whatever you want to print on the screen, you're supposed to put it in double quotation mark. Example, here we have put please enter a value. This is gonna be displayed on the screen. And next up we have scanf statement. Scanf statement does nothing but reading the value entered by the user. So whenever a user, like if you want to give an input through your keyboard, right? That time you're, suppose I've given 5 as the input over here. This particular I variable will take up that I, and percentage %d is nothing but string formatting. Why do we need format string? That is nothing but it informs the scanf function what type of input to expect. So if you're giving percentage %d, then the scanf will tell that it is of integer type. If you're giving percentage %f, scanf or printf, scan or print a floating point number. If you're giving percentage %c, it'll just tell the compiler to scan or print a character. If you're giving percentage %s, it'll tell to scan or print a character string. So this is nothing but format strings where it'll just inform you guys that it is of so and so type of data. Okay, I'm just gonna show you the output of this particular program. Build compile current file. Please enter a value. As you can see in our printf function, we had please enter a value. So it'll just show that particular thing. And now scanf will take in the data from our keyboard. So if you are giving 5 over here, our next printf statement had you entered percentage %d. So percentage %d, we will, in order to tell which variable exactly it is, we give the variable number after the comma mark. So it'll just show in that particular number, whatever we have inputted in. Next up, we have getCare function. GetCare and putCare is also other two type of input and output function. What does getCare do? GetCare function is nothing but it takes in a single character, okay? It can't take in an entire variable name. Like if you're giving Atharved as a name, it will just take A because it'll just take in single character and not the entire string. Whereas putCare displays that particular thing. Here we are taking a character as input and we are storing it into the C variable. And next, we are to display it, we use putCare function, and this particular thing will be a display. Example, enter a character, say Atharved. When you're giving Atharved, it'll take in only A, like it'll show you only a single character and it'll omit the other characters, whatever is present. Because what putCare and getCare does is, it'll take in only a single character. But if you're using get s and put s functions, it'll take in a string. Like if you're giving Atharved, it'll display the entire thing out. And if you get s reads the particular string and put s displays that particular string, whatever you're giving. Okay, what is C operators? An operator is a symbol that tells the compiler to perform specific mathematical or logical function. C language is rich in built-in operators and provides the following types of operators. So first we'll look up into arithmetic operators. Arithmetic operators is nothing but our basic whatever we use, mathematical functions, that is plus, minus, multiplication, division, modulus. Modulus operator gives you the remainder of an integer or a division. And then we have increment operator and decrement operator. Increment operator, what it does is, here we have given A as 10, right, and B as 20. So increment operator just increments the that particular value by 1, and decrement operator just decreases that particular value by 1. So if we have 20 over here, it'll increment by 21, and if we have decrement operator for B, then it'll give you as 19. Relational operators. What does relational operators do? It will check if A and B, checks if the value of two operands are equal or not. In our case, if A is 10 and B is equal to 20, that means it is not true, right? So it'll just come not true. And not equal to operator, what it does is it checks if the two operands are equal or not. If the values are not equal, then the condition becomes true. In our case, it is true because A's value is 10 and B's value is 20. So they are not equal. So you'll get an output as true. And greater and smaller, that is checks if the value of the left operand is greater than the value of the right operand. In our case, it is not true. And if checks if the value of left operand is less than the value of right operand, in our case, that is 10 is less than B, 20, that is true. And greater than or equal to and less than or equal to does the same thing. Next up, we have logical operators. Logical AND operator. If both the operands are non-zero, then the condition becomes false. Okay. If now A 10 and A are both non-zero thing, so they both will become false. And called logical OR operator. If any of the two operands is non-zero, then the condition becomes true. And in called logical NOT operator, it is used to reverse whatever answer you have got. Like A and B is false, right? So if you are using NOT operator, then it'll become true. Next up, we have bitwise operator. I'm just gonna give an example over here. Assume A is equal to 60 and B is equal to 13. In binary format, you'll get A is equal to so and so thing and B is equal to so and so. Now, if you see in bitwise operator, this is nothing but binary AND operator. Okay, binary AND operator copies a bit to the result only if both the operands exist. Like if both the operands are 1, then only it will give in the result as 1. If one of the operand is 0, then the output or result will be 0. In bitwise, in binary OR operator, if one of the operand is 1, then the result will be 1. If both the operands are 0, then the result will be 0. In binary XOR operator, if both the operands are same, then the output result will be 0. If one of the operands are different from each other, then the output will be 1. So as we are gonna see here, A and B, we are considering it like this, right? So A binary and B, you'll get it as 0 and 1. And is nothing but of multiplication form, okay? So if there is 1, 0, then output will be 0. So 0, 0, 0, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, and the 0, 1, 0, so it continues so on. A or B works just like addition. So 0 and 1, 1, 0 and 0, 0, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 0, 0, 0. A XOR B is nothing but if both the things are same, then it's going to be 0. If both the things are different, then it's going to be 1. So that's how XOR operator works. Complement of A is nothing but if it is 0, then it'll become 1. If it is 1, then it'll become 0. So that's how a bitwise operator works. Next up, we have assignment operators. So assignment operators are nothing but you will do some function over here, taking a plus b. So if you're doing a plus b, then you're giving that particular value to c. So equal to sign does that. Simple assignment operator assigns value from right side operand to left side operand. Here plus equal to what it does is, take this example, c is equal to c plus a. So c plus a is nothing but, okay, you can take in sum as an example, okay? If you want to take the same sum, if your initializing sum is equal to zero, and if you want to use that sum again, so instead of like using it again and again, like giving the same variable name, you this particular expression is equivalent to this thing. So c plus equal to a is nothing but c is equal to c plus a. Similarly, minus equal to, multiplication equal to, division equal to, all of these things does the same thing. Even the left shift and assignment operator, right shift and assignment operator, bitwise and operator, and bitwise exclusive OR and bitwise inclusive OR. Next up, we have MISC operators, size of ternary operators. Size of is nothing but it returns the size of a variable. In our case, what was the value of a? 10, right? So if 10 was an integer, 10 occupies, integer occupies 2 bytes of memory space. So 0 will occupy 2 bytes, 1 will occupy 2 bytes. So total size of a is nothing but 4. And if you're checking and address of variable, if you're giving address of A, then it'll just return you the address of that particular A, where exactly that particular A is stored. Pointer variable will give you the value of that particular variable. Conditional expression, what it does is, it'll take in an expression like A. I'll just give you an example. Okay, so here we have A's value as 10. So if you're giving A's value as 10 and B is another variable which will hold that particular data, okay? So if A is equal to 1, if this particular thing is true, then your output will be 20. If A is not equal to 1, then your output will be 30. Similarly, in this case, our value will be 20, and in this case, our value will be 30. Because in this case, in our second case where a is equal to 10, that is true, right? So our answer will be 20. And I'll just try doing it. Yeah, so we have MISC operators. Value of B is nothing but in our first case 30, because the condition is false, and the value of B is 20 because the condition is true, and the value of A is 10, right? So if you're giving size of operator here, size of A, then you'll get the answer as 4. So this is how it works. And if you want to check relational operators, that is here. So if A is equal to B, this is, it checks if A is equal to B or not. So in our case, the value of A is 21 and B is 10. So if 21 is equal to 10, then you will, line 1, A is equal to B, or else it is not. In our case, it is false, right? So it'll print if, the next statement over here. A is not equal to B. So this is how operational relational operators work. And then we have the simple addition, multiplication, subtraction, and division modulus thing. So if you're taking A plus B, you will get it as 31. And then you'll just print that particular C value over here. And then 11, multiplication, division, modulus, and increment and decrement operator. Next up is control statements. Control statements, C provides two styles of flow control, that is branching and looping. What branching does is, branching is deciding what actions to take. Looping is deciding how many times to take a certain action. So in branching, we have if statement. Okay, I'll just give you an example of if statements. So here you see, first our compiler will ask us enter any digit number. Say we take it as 10. So in this is our first condition. Okay, if statement. If 10 is modulus 5 is equal to 0, that is, it checks if it is divisible by 5 or not. So if it is divisible by 5, then it will print this particular statement, that is, given number is divisible by 5. If it is not divisible by 5, then it will directly jump on to the next printf statement, that is, statement does not belong to if. If you're giving any number which is not divisible by 5, then this particular statement will execute. Let us just check it. So when I give 29, statement does not belong to if. That is, it will just omit this particular condition, and then the next printf statement works. But if you're giving 10, which is divisible by 5, given number is divisible by 5. So it'll just print out like that. So next up we have if else statement. What if else does is, if one condition is true, then it'll perform, it'll give, that statement will be executed. If not, okay, see this flow diagram. If one it'll test the first condition. If it is true, then a set of true block of statements will work in. If that particular condition is false, then the other false block of statements will work. And then whatever the next statements are there, normal statements will work. So the if-else statement is used to verify the given condition and executes only one out of the two block of statement based on the condition result. If the if-else statement evaluates the specified condition, if it is true, it executes a block of statements. If the condition false, it executes another block of statements. So this is our syntax. Syntax is nothing but generally how the code should be. Okay. Here we are checking if a given number is odd or not. So if I run this code, let me give 8. 8. Given number is even. So if the condition is true, it will just execute this particular statement. It won't even go to the next statement. If I give in another value, say 5, since the condition is false, it won't execute this particular statement. It'll just execute the next printf statement. So that's how if else statement works. And next up we have nested if statements. What does nested if statement do? If it checks one condition, the first condition, if it is true, then that particular statement is printed on. If it is false, then it'll check the next if condition. If again that particular thing is false, it keeps on looping like this itself until there's a default statement out there. You will understand it better if I give you an example. So see this, this is also, this is used to check if a given number is even or odd under less below 100 numbers, okay? So we are giving first condition if n is equal to, n is less than 100. So n, enter any digit number. If I'm giving 5 is less than 100. So it will check only the numbers that is below 100, that we have given condition in such a way. So first we'll print that the given number is below 100. And if the next if condition will be checked, if that particular number is odd or even. If it is odd, then it'll perform one even function, else it'll perform another function. So if this, if it is not at all, if it does not belong less than 100, then this entire, entire function won't work. The next else statement will work. Let me just give you an example. So first I will give more than 100, okay? So given number is not below, so it won't perform any of these things. It'll directly come out of the if statement and it'll check the else thing, and then it'll print given number is not below 100. But if you're giving another input which is less than 100, say 99, then the given below a given number, the first printf statement will work, that is given number is below 100. And next, it'll check if the number is an even number or odd number. This is nothing but if inside if. So that's how nested if works. And next up, we have switch statements. What switch statement does is it'll take in one expression or value and it checks each case. So if first case is true, then that particular set of statement will execute and it won't even bother to check the other cases. Okay, and then it'll just come out of this particular loop. If this first case doesn't match, it'll go on to the second case. If second case doesn't, third, it goes on like this. And if it doesn't match any of the case, then the default set of statement, whatever is present, that thing will work. So we'll see another example for switch statement. Okay, here we have, given any input that is of integer data type, say 5. So if you're taking 5, the n value will be 5 over here and will check each case. In the first case, the expression is 0. Is n matching 0? No, right? Because our n value is 5. So it will go up to our case 5 thing, and if our case 5 matches 5. So it will print if 5 as the output and it'll just break. Break is a unconditional loop where it doesn't even bother to go and check the other cases. It'll just break out of this entire set and then it'll give you the output. Say 10. So 10 is not in our case, right? So the default statement will print out. It is not a digit. But if I'm giving any number that is in our case, say 4, then it will just print in our case for whatever the statements are there, that particular thing will be printed out. Next up we have while loop. So looping statements are nothing but to execute a single statement or block of statement repeatedly as long as the given condition is true. So we are using while loop. We check one condition until and unless this condition is false, right? This particular block of statement keeps on working. So if the condition becomes false, then it'll just come out of that particular loop. And then whatever statements are there out of that loop, that will work. And do while is also similar to that. But in our do while statements, a block of statements will execute first and then the condition is checked. If that condition is true only, then it'll go back to that particular block of statement. If it is false, then it'll come out of that loop. For statement works similar to do and while, but for statements is much easier compared to do or while. Because in for statement, in a single statement itself, you can initialize, you can give a condition, you can give any modification that you want. And after giving that particular thing, a block of statements can be used. Okay, I'll give you an example. So while works like this. This is also the same thing. Check if the number is even or even number up to 10. Okay, we have to give the set of numbers which is even up to 10. So say while n is less than or equal to 10, if that particular number gives a remainder of 0, that means it's an even number, right? So it will print that particular number and it'll increment, it'll go to the next number. And this it will happen continuously until this particular condition becomes false. That is when n becomes more than 10, that time this particular loop will stop. So if you're checking the output now, so our output will be like this. So first, we have initialized n's value as 0. So 0 is less than or equal to 10. Yeah, it is true. And 0 modulus 2 is equal to 0. Yeah, so it will print in 0 value. and it will increment n's value. That n's value was 0, right? It'll become 1. Is 1 less than or equal to 10? It is true. Is 1 modulus 2 is equal to 0? It is false. So it will just do the n plus plus, that is increment of that particular thing. It will become 2. Is 2 less than or equal to 10? It is true. Is 2 modulus 2 is equal to 0? That is true, and it will print 2. So it keeps on happening until the condition is 10. So if you see 10 is less than or equal to 2 is true, and then it'll print the value of 10. But when it comes to 11, 11 is not less than or equal to 10, right? So that time the condition becomes false and the execution will stop. Similar to that, we have do while. In do while loop, first the statements will be executed, and then it will check the condition if that particular number is true or not. So it's similar to that only. So you will give, you will get like this 0, 2, 4, 6, 8, 10. Next up, we have for statements. In our for statements, there we had initialized in our declaration part, right? N is equal to 10. We don't have to do that. In our one single statement itself, we can give N is equal to 0, N is less than or equal to 10, N plus plus. And then one single if statement and printf statement is enough for us to check if this particular thing is working or not. So this is how it works. So it's the same output. Next, moving on to unconditional control statements. The above three statements do not need any condition to control the program. Okay, so all of these while loop, for loop and all needed a condition for it to stop, right? But break, continue, go to need not have any sort of, a hold or a condition that is required to stop the program. So break statement, wherever you put in the between, it'll just come out of the loop and work in other statements. So it does not need or it does not require any sort of condition for it to stop the program. Continue statement works in a way, so what continue statement does is it will print one value and will go back again to the beginning of the program and will just execute until we encounter that the condition is false. So we have while one. While one is used until the condition is true. Okay, so we have enter any digit number. So our first printf statement, that is, it'll take up any number. Let me take 8. So it'll show that entered number is even. And what continue statement does it? It'll take it back again to the starting printf statements. Again, it'll ask us to enter another number, say 4. Again, it'll go back to the starting thing until and unless the condition becomes false. If I give now 3, the program will stop because it doesn't execute this particular statement. It'll go back to the else statement and it'll encounter the exit thing. So that's how continue statement works. And then we have go to statements. Go to statements has nothing but the go to statement is used to jump from one line to another line in the program. Using go to statement, we can jump from top to bottom or bottom to top. To jump from one line to another line, the go-to statement requires a label. Okay, label is a name given to the instruction or line in the program. When we use a go-to statement in the program, the execution control directly jumps to the line in the specified label. So this is how it works. So printf, we have first is we are at the first printf statement. And next up, we have go-to last. So last is the label that we have. So when you're giving go to last, it will omit these two printf statements and it'll just execute the last printf statement that is there in the go to statement. So we have build, compile, current, build and run. So as you can see, the first printf statement, we are at the first printf statement. And then it'll just go to the last, whatever we have given the label, and it'll just execute. We are at the last printf statement. It'll omit these two printf statements. So that's it. That's it for the webinar session of coding, basics of coding today.